Wilkinson bar divider. In the last video, we have studied T-junction bar divider, and we said that there are two types of T-junction bar dividers, lossless T-junction bar divider and lossy T-junction bar divider. And we said that the lossless T-junction bar divider suffers from the advantage of the disadvantage of not being matched at all ports, and it doesn't have isolation between the output ports. On the other hand, for lossy T-junction or resistive T-junction divider, it can be matched at all ports, but even so, it is not lossless, and also the isolation is still not achieved between the ports. Now in this video, we are going to introduce another type of bar divider, which is known as Wilkinson bar divider, which is characterized by being matched at all ports, and at the same time the output ports are isolated with respect to each other. So we say that Wilkinson bar divider is a network with useful property of appearing lossless when the output ports are matched. If the output ports are matched, it would be lossless, and only reflect power from the output ports is dissipated in a shunt resistance between the two arms of the output. The geometry of Wilkinson bar divider is as shown here. We have an input board with characteristic impedance Z0. This input board is divided into two paths. Each path has a characteristic impedance equal square root 2 Z0, and actually this value for the case of equal bar division, and the length of each path is lambda guide by 4. At the end of the two paths, we have two terminals of characteristic impedance with the original characteristic impedance Z0. So we return back from square root Z0 to Z0, and the end of the two transmission lines with the characteristic impedance square root 2 Z0 are terminated or are connected with a shunt resistance. The shunt resistance has a magnitude equals 2 multiplied by Z0. So assuming that we are talking about transmission line with characteristic impedance 50 ohm, this means that the input transmission line section will have characteristic impedance 50 ohm, and the two divider sections will have a characteristic impedance of around 70.7 ohm. The length of these divider sections will have a length about lambda guide over 4, and at the end of the two divider sections there's a shunt resistance equals 100 ohm, and the output ports are connected directly through transmission lines with characteristic impedance 50 ohms. This assuming that Z0 equal 50 ohms. The geometric circle, or for an equal bar division, for an equal bar division, the characteristic impedance of the two arms of the divider will be different from each other, such that we have a feeding transmission line with characteristic impedance Z0. The bar at the input section will be divided between two transmission line sections, one with characteristic impedance Z2 and the other with characteristic impedance Z3. Then certain resistive load R, depending on the bar, the required bar division ratio, certain resistance R will be connected at the two terminals between the output of the divider. Then the output of the divider would be connected through transmission lines to different loads. So, unlike equal divisions, in equal divisions, the output will have the same characteristic impedance of the input. But in an equal power division, the output impedances will be different from one to other. In this case, the characteristic impedance of output number 2, it will have a characteristic impedance Z naught multiplied by K. However, the characteristic impedance of output 3 will have a characteristic impedance equal Z naught over K, where K is the power division ratio between port 2 and port 3. As we see, if the value of K is unity, we return back to the case of equal power division. The question now is how we obtain these designs, or what is the analysis of Wilkinson power divider. To study the analysis of Wilkinson power divider, it would be required to divide the solution into two modes of operation. One mode is called even mode of operation or even mode analysis, and the other mode is odd mode analysis. In even mode analysis, we start from the two output ports with two voltage sources of the same magnitude and the same phase, and the input port would be terminated. And we see how to make the two output ports would be matched to the input port, and how much power will be transferred from these two sources to the input power. This is even mode. On the other hand, at the odd mode, we have also two equal sources, but they are out of phase. So if this is positive, this would be negative. So this is what we are calling odd mode analysis. And once again, the output terminal would be terminated with a matched load, and we will see how the power is going from port 2, port 3 to port 1 in the odd mode. Actually, the combination or the superposition solution between even and odd modes will add the total voltage at one terminal and subtract the total voltage at the other terminal. So in this case, we can obtain direct the relation between one port to the input port. In a similar way, we can obtain the relation between the input port and the other output port. This is briefly our strategy to solve such a Wilkinson power divider. So we start with dividing the problem into two problems, one for even mode and one for odd mode. In this video, we are going to present the analysis for the even mode. To avoid make this video too long, the odd mode will be discussed in the following video. That's what I'm saying, even odd mode analysis of Wilkinson power divider. We are going to connect the two output terminals by VG2 and VG3 and connect the output port with a terminated or a matched termination. In our analysis, we are going to normalize all the impedances with respect to the characteristic impedance Z naught. So all the characteristic impedance will be divided by Z naught, such that the characteristic impedance of the output line, it would be 1, 1. And because here we have characteristic impedance 1, and we are going to present it into two barrel arms, so these two barrel arms to be equivalent to 1, they will have a characteristic impedance 2 and 2. So 2 and 2 barrel to each other will have a characteristic impedance equals 1. And assuming that we don't know previously that the characteristic impedance of the two sections of the power dividers are square root Z naught, so we are going to assume that it is Z. And we are going to prove that the value or the required value of Z is square root 2, which means that the characteristic impedance of this transmission line section should be square root 2 multiplied by Z naught. However, we are still assuming that the length of this transmission line sections of the power divider is lambda by 4. So, the equivalent circuit that we are going to study is replacing the feeding transmission line terminated by Z naught by two parallel resistances, each one equals 2 because we are normalizing everything to Z naught. So the this barrier combination is equivalent to a resistance equal 1, and these two resistances are connected through transmission line sections of characteristic impedance Z, and Z here is normalized with respect to 1. These transmission line sections have a length of lambda guide by 4, and then there is a resistance between the two terminals or the two ends of the power divider arms. This resistance we are going to call it R, and should be R here is normalized also with respect to Z naught, so directly it would be R multiplied by Z naught. And because the problem would be symmetric, so we are going to represent the resistance between the two arms as two resistors in series to each other. So it would be R over 2 plus R over 2. Then the outputs of the two arms of the divider would be connected to transmission lines originally of characteristic impedance Z naught, and because Z naught is normalized, so it would be connected to transmission lines of impedance 1. And this would be connected to a source at port 2 VG2 and a source at port 3 VG3. And as I said, we are going to normalize all impedances to the characteristic impedance Z naught. Voltage generators at the output ports, the Wilkinson power divider circuit is normalized and symmetric form. Now we are going to define two separate modes of operation or of excitation: even mode excitation and odd mode excitation. In even mode excitation, the voltage source at port 2 will have the same magnitude and the same phase of the voltage source at port 3. So VG2 equals VG3, and we are going to assume that it is 2V naught. On the other hand, the odd mode, in this mode, the voltage at port 2 will equal the same amplitude of the voltage at port 3 but out of phase. So VG2 equals minus VG3 equals 2V naught. We are going to solve this problem separately and solve this problem separately, and then by superposition of these two modes we can obtain the solution. If we are going to add these two conditions or these two modes, in these two modes, if we are added them from the voltage points view, the total voltage at VG2 it would be 4V naught, and the total voltage at VG3 it would be 0. This means that if the voltage here is 0, we are terminating the output port with a characteristic impedance equal unity or normalized characteristic impedance equal unity, and we have input voltage source equal 4V naught at the port number 1. So from this superposition we can obtain the relation between port number 2 and port number 1. From this we can obtain S21. In a similar way, instead of addition, if we are going subtraction, in subtraction the voltage at port 2 it would be 0, and the voltage at port 3 it would be 4V0. And in this case, we can obtain the relation between port 1 and port 3. So, our strategy now is to study this circuit at first for even mode, then study the same circuit for odd mode, then by superposition, we can obtain the relation between port 1 and port 2, port 1 and port 3. In this way, we can obtain the main characteristics of this power divider. Let us start with even mode analysis of Wilkinson power divider. As I said, in even mode analysis, the voltage at port 2 equals voltage at port 3 as a magnitude and phase. This means that the two sections of the Wilkinson power divider are symmetric with respect to each other. Especially, or we are talking about equal power division. Okay? So, in this case, if the voltage VG2 will introduce positive voltage 2 at the port number 2, and voltage V3 will introduce positive V3 at port 3, then from the symmetry of the problem, V2 should equal V3. This means that if the potential at this point equals the potential at this point, there will be no current passing from this point to this point. This means that the current in this path would be zero. In a similar way, if the voltage passes through this transmission line section here, and this voltage passes through this transmission line section here to the node number 1, actually, the potential at this terminal equals the potential at this terminal. This once again means that there is no current between this terminal and this terminal because they are equipotential. This means that we can divide this problem to half the problem with replacing these nodes by simply open circuit because there is no current passing through this nodes. This means we can study only half the circuit by eliminating these two nodes by open circuits. And if we study the upper half, it would be the same as the lower half. Alright? Okay. Now, the problem has been converted to such simple circuit. This is a load with characteristic impedance 2 connected to a transmission line of length lambda by 4. This transmission line section has a characteristic impedance Z. And at the end of this transmission line section, it is connected through a transmission line or impedance of normalized impedance 1 connected to the voltage source. And this parallel component is neglected because actually it is open circuit. So actually the input admittance from this bus is infinity. So if I'm talking this parallel to this, this actually 1 over infinity, it would be 0. This means this part and this part are not included in the analysis because they are open circuits. Right? Okay. Now, let us study step by step. At the beginning, we are interested to find out the input impedance at port 2 looking from this side. So, if I'm looking from this side, the input impedance it would be the impedance of a transmission line section of length lambda by 4, which has a characteristic impedance Z, and terminated at its end by a load impedance Z load equals 2. We remember that for a transmission terminated transmission line section if the characteristic impedance of the transmission line section is Z naught and terminated by Z load. So the input impedance after a distance L is Zn equals Z naught multiplied by Z load plus jZ naught tan beta L over Z naught plus jZ load tan beta L. Okay, now in the present case, what is called Z naught is Z. What is called Z load is 2. And beta L at the present case, beta is 2 pi over lambda and L is lambda by 4. This means that beta L is pi over 2. Tan pi over 2 is nearly infinity. Tan pi over 2 is infinity. This means that we have a small value plus a very large value. So the large value will be the dominant. Over a small value plus very large value. So the large value would be the dominant. Means that we can ignore the value of Z load compared to JZ naught tan beta L when L is lambda by 4. And we can ignore Z naught compared to JZ load tan beta L when L is lambda over 4. So Z input in this case is Z naught multiplied by JZ naught tan beta L over JZ load tan beta L. J it would be eliminated with J. So we have Z naught squared tan beta L over Z load tan beta L. Tan beta L can be eliminated with beta L, tan beta L. So the result here in the present case when the length is lambda over 4 is Z naught squared over ZL. And as I said, in the present case, Z naught here corresponds to Z. And Z load corresponds to 2. So the input impedance seen from this board is Z squared over 2. The input impedance seen from this board, if I'm looking to the left side, the input impedance of the even mode would be Z squared over 2. The problem now is how much Z, or what is the value of Z such that this input impedance will be matched to a characteristic impedance equal 1? What is the value of Z such that the input impedance seen toward left here at board 2 would be matched to a characteristic impedance equal 1? This means that it is required to make Z input even equals 1. And if Z even equals 1, this means that Z square equals 2. Or in other words, the value or the required value of Z should equal square root 2. Square root 2. And this is actually what we are expecting, because in Wilkinson bar divider, the characteristic impedance of the divider section is square root 2 multiplied by Z naught. And because we are normalizing with respect to Z naught, so the required normalized characteristic impedance in this case, Z should equal square root 2. So from this, we have already proved that the value of Z, or the value of the normalized Z, it should be square root 2. Okay? Alright. Now, that's what we are seeing. Then looking into board 2, looking towards the left side, Z input even equals Z squared over 2. And if Z equals 2, then board 2 will be matched. Would be matched, why? Because Z input in this case, it would be 1 for even mode excitation. If Z input equal 1, if Z input here equal 1, this means that we have a simple power divider between 1, the series characteristic impedance here, and 1, which is the input impedance seen here. So in this case, the input voltage V2 at this point, it would be the voltage at the generator, which is 2V0, multiplied by 1 over 1 plus 1, which is 2. So it would be 2V0 over 2, it would be V0. This means that the voltage at the terminal of the board, in this case at board number 2, in this case it would be simply V0. Right? Okay. The question now, we have already calculated the voltage at board 2. It is also required to determine the voltage at port 1. To determine the voltage at port 1, actually, the voltage here would propagate through this transmission line section to reach port 1. And at port 1, here, the characteristic impedance of the transmission line, of this transmission line, is square root 2. And the load terminating this transmission line is 2. This means that there will be reflection coefficient at the terminal 1 coming from the impedance 2 connected to a characteristic impedance square root 2. So the reflection coefficient at this point gamma equals Z load minus Z naught over Z load plus Z naught. Z load is 2 minus Z naught, which we have already proved, square root 2 over 2 plus square root 2. This is a reflection coefficient at this point. The voltage at any point along this transmission line, it can be represented as V incident plus V reflected, or V incident multiplied by 1 plus reflection coefficient. So we can represent the voltage at any point x along this transmission line section as the incident voltage V plus multiplied by the propagation constant e to the power minus j beta x, the forward propagation constant, plus gamma multiplied by e to the power j beta x, the backward propagation constant. And gamma here is the reflection coefficient at this point. Assuming that here x equals 0 and here x equals minus lambda over 4. Assuming that this is the positive direction of x. X here equals 0 and x here equals minus lambda over 4. So at this point, the total voltage would be given by V at x equals minus lambda over 4. We are going to replace the value of x by minus lambda over 4 and the value of x here by minus lambda over 4. So minus minus would be positive. J beta lambda over 4. We said that beta multiplied by lambda over 4 is pi over 2. So this part it would be e to the power j pi over 2. We have here minus minus would be positive. So e to the positive j pi over 2. E to the positive j pi over 2 is j. And in a similar way, this would be e to the power minus j pi over 2. So this would be minus j. If we take j as a common factor, so the total voltage at the point x equal minus lambda over 4, it would be j multiplied by v plus multiplied by 1 minus gamma. The minus is coming from this terminal with respect to this terminal. So it would be j v plus multiplied by 1 minus gamma. And actually this quantity equal the voltage that we already calculated at the point 2. So V at the point 2 equals V naught. So this quantity is V naught. From this we can obtain the magnitude of the incident voltage inside this transmission line section. So we can say that V plus equals V naught over J multiplied by 1 minus gamma. And actually 1 over J is minus J. in the denominator. So we can say it is minus JV naught over 1 minus gamma. Or we can say that it is JV naught over gamma minus 1. Alright? So we can replace V plus by J V naught over gamma minus 1. We have already calculated the value of V plus. Now, if you are interested to find out the voltage at the port 1 here, V1 in the even mode. So, V1 at the even mode is actually the value of the voltage across this transmission line section at x equals 0. So, by replacing x is 0, this would be 1 plus gamma. So, V at x equals 0 is V plus multiplied by 1 plus gamma. And already we said that V plus can be replaced by J multiplied by V naught over gamma minus 1. So we can replace V plus by J V naught over gamma minus 1. This means that the voltage at the port 1 at the even mode would equal J V naught multiplied by gamma plus 1 over gamma minus 1. And already we know that the value of gamma at this transmission line section is 2 minus square root 2, or 2 minus z, and z actually we have obtained as square root 2, 2 minus square root 2 over 2 plus square root 2. By applying the value of this gamma in this equation, we can obtain that the value of the voltage V1e, the voltage at port 1 in the even mode, is minus JV naught square root 2. So now we have obtained the value of the required characteristic impedance of the transmission line section such that the even mode will be matched, and we obtain the voltage at the port 2 and the voltage at the port 1 for the even mode. We are going in the next video to repeat the same steps for the odd mode. Then, by making superposition from the even and odd mode, we are going to obtain the characteristics of the Wilkinson power divider. Alright? See you in the next video to complete the Wilkinson power divider.